Hello friends, this is Dr. Rajal Shah. Thank you for joining my YouTube channel, Expert Urologic Pathology. In this channel, I try to bring simplified approaches to diagnosis of urological cancers, high yield topics, as well as emerging new science. Don't forget to like this video, also subscribe to channel. That will help me build this more amazing content for this channel. So today I try to bring you a simplified diagnostic approach to adrenal mass evaluation. This is a quite complex subject, which I have tried to simplify that. And so let's get started. So the challenges in adrenal mass evaluation are threefold. Number one, you could have difficulty in distinction of adrenal from non-adrenal tumor. Within the primary adrenal tumor, distinction of adrenal cortical from adrenal medullary tumor could be challenging. And then the third difficulty is determination of the malignant potential of primary adrenal tumor. So here is my simplified approach. And for that, I think we will go systematically try to understand the anatomy and physiology. So adrenal glands are bilateral pyramidal shape glands, which are situated on the upper pole of the kidney. They have three parts: head towards the medial aspect, then body, and then tail. It is composed of an outer layer of adrenal cortical cells, which are made up of three cells, three layers, which we will talk later on. And then you have inner highly vascular area, which is the adrenal medulla. So the adrenal gland, as we know, is critical in maintaining body's homeostasis, typically involved in fight and flight reaction for various situations. So it is very critical in the normal physiological balance of human body. And it is also a highly vascular organ, and that is a reason that it is frequently site for metastasis, and we will talk more about that as well. Adrenal cortex, adrenal gland is the site of variety of pathologies. Majority of them are primary adrenal pathology. As you can see here, majority, over 52% of the tumors, are typically benign adenoma. About equal proportions of these 11-12% are adrenocortical carcinomas and pheochromocytomas. You can also have a significant number of myelolipomas. Many of them are incidentally discovered tumors. And then you have adrenal cysts, some neuronal tumors, which are typically seen more in younger age tumors, younger age patients, and I will not talk a whole lot about that. And then another very important spectrum is the metastasis. So in patients with metastatic tumors, adrenal gland is often the site of the metastasis, and we will talk more about that. So with increasing application of imaging technologies like renal cell carcinoma, adrenal cortical tumors are also increasingly detected incidentally. Patient walks to the clinic for some unrelated symptoms or presentation, ends up getting imaging evaluation with a diagnosis of adrenal tumor. So this type of finding is also known as incidental adenoma or incidentally detected adrenal tumor. So when you once detect that type of tumor, the first important evaluation is whether the tumor is functioning or not. And typically three type of tests are important: urine metanephrine evaluation that typically measures epinephrine and norepinephrine. You also need plasma ratio of plasma aldosterone concentration to plasma renin activity, and then 1 mg dexamethasone suppression test. So based on these three evaluations, lab parameters, you determine whether the tumor is functioning or not. And as you can see here, that any functioning tumor patient would need a surgical resection to evaluate potential malignant potential within that particular tumor. If the tumor is non-functioning, which is now increasingly discovered because of these imaging modalities, in this type of setting, larger tumors tend to be more malignant. So there is often a size criteria. If the tumors are less than 3 centimeter, typically they are observed, but greater than 5 centimeter, patient would undergo adrenalectomy. And for patient tumors with 3 to 5 centimeter, depending on the other overall patient situation, I think they are managed accordingly. So this is a simplified approach how patients with adrenal mass are managed. So here is my simplified diagnostic approach, and we will talk more about this at each step later on. The first important thing is to ask yourself, am I dealing with a primary adrenal pathology? If question is yes, am I dealing with adrenal cortical pathology or adrenal medullary pathology? It may not be clear in many situations. So in that situation, you need further immunohistochemical markers. The panel typically that I used includes cytokeratin, inhibin, calreticulin, SF1, MELAN-A, and chromocranin. If you determine that you are dealing with a primary adrenal pathology, then it is important to further determine whether you are dealing with a benign, malignant, or in a certain situation you are not sure, and that can be tumor of uncertain malignant potential. So we will talk a whole lot about this particular aspect. You could be dealing with some other tumors like myelolipoma, adrenal cyst. Next important question is, if you are not dealing with primary adrenal pathology or you are not sure about whether you are dealing with primary or non-adrenal pathology, then I think you have two other important questions to ask. Am I dealing with a non-adrenal pathology or I'm not sure about that? And for that, you will need further immunohistochemical workup depending on the type of morphology as well as patient's history and other conditions. So before you start evaluation of these specimens, here is the checklist that you should have ready. And I think that will really help you to determine and narrow down your differential diagnosis. What is the age I am dealing with? What is the clinical presentation? Am I dealing with a functioning or a non-functioning tumors? What are the imaging characteristics? Am I dealing with a unilateral or bilateral involvement? Steroid hormone levels. What is the urine catecholamine levels? Am I dealing with a biopsy or resection specimen? Biopsy is typically would not be done for a pheochromocytoma type of situation, because biopsy can induce a catastrophic reaction to the patient. So typically biopsy would be done in a more setting of non-functional type of tumor where you have a question of potentially metastasis. Otherwise, most of the time you are going to receive more adrenal resection type of specimen. If you have adrenal resection specimen, what is the size and weight of the tumor? And that can help you again, determine the potential malignant nature of the tumor. So let us, our first question that we will try to address is, am I dealing with an adrenal cortical pathology? So adrenal, it is very important to understand the normal histology of adrenal cortex, which is arranged in this type of zonal distribution. And there are three cells within this zonal distribution: outer small, very compact cells, which are referred to as a zona glomerulosa. Then you have a bulk of this zone is composed of this type of clear, bubbly, vacuolated type of cells, which are known as zona fasciculata, which are also very lipid-rich cells, which gives it that bubbly character to it. And then inner zona reticularis cells, which are compact and pigmented cells. So here is a more close-up look of this three-cell population. Outer zona glomerulosa, bulk of zona fasciculata cells, and then zona reticularis cells, which are again compact and eosinophilic pigmented, often pigmented cells. Depending on these cells, and again, I think note this very bubbly character of this adrenal cortical cells that can be very helpful to distinguish it from renal cell carcinoma, which often could be a problematic situation in differential diagnosis. Adrenal, primary adrenal cortical pathology has this type of bubbly type of cells, while renal cell carcinoma, even though has a clear cytoplasm, don't have this type of bubbly cytoplasm. And this is especially helpful when you are dealing with a small needle biopsy type of specimens. So here is the hormones that they produce. Zona glomerulosa produces aldosterone. Zona fasciculata produces the cortisol, and zona reticularis produces sex steroid hormones. So again, depending on the functioning nature of the tumor, you can determine that what cells are likely contributing towards the development of the tumor. So let's talk about adrenal cortical adenoma, which is going to be the bulk of these specimens that you will encounter. These are typically well-circumscribed, lipid-rich, like yellow tumors. They are composed of heterogeneous group of benign neoplasm that can differentiate toward any cortical layer. So depending on the type of function, you could be dealing with a Kahn syndrome, which is aldosterone overproduction, Cushing syndrome, which has a typically glucocorticoids secretion, and then you have adrenogenital syndrome, which produces virilizing and feminizing symptoms due to production of those sex hormones. Small proportion of this tumor can be very heavily pigmented, are also known as black adenoma. Typically, again, zona reticularis type of cells are likely contributing to this type of adenomas. And as we talked about that, now increasingly, because of increasing application of imaging modalities, these tumors are often detected when they are non-functional. And these tumors are typically less than 100 gram and unilateral. If they are bilateral, then you are likely dealing with a more adrenocortical hyperplasia, and that distinction sometime could be resolved with the proper imaging evaluation and correlation. So, adrenal cortical adenomas are typically characterized by a variable number of vacuolated clear cells and small compact eosinophilic cells, which are arranged in small nest, cords, and alveolar arrangements. So there is a very organized appearance that you would see. Typically, you have small nest of cells separated by this very rich, delicate reticulin type of network, as you can appreciate here at this higher magnification. And in this particular case, you can see that tumor is predominantly composed of clear vacuolated lipid-rich cells, but is it often common to find the variable mixture of this type of cells? But typically, in my experience, you are going to see more clear cells rather than more eosinophilic cells. If you have more eosinophilic cells, then we need to be a little bit more careful about the malignant potential for that particular tumor, and we will talk more about that. At low power examination, again, you can see that it's a nodular circumscribed proliferation. You are often going to find a compressed normal adrenal tissue, which is a good clue to suggest that you are dealing with an adenoma compared to adrenocortical hyperplasia. But that, again, you need to correlate with the imaging characteristics. For patients who are receiving spironolactone treatment, you may see this type of spironolactone bodies, which are composed of eosinophilic laminated type of secretions, which are typically myelin-rich bodies. And this is just an incidental finding. It has nothing to do with the malignant potential, but more often you see in Kahn syndrome and patients who are being treated with this particular treatment. So next important spectrum is adrenocortical carcinoma, and I think we will focus heavily on this particular one to determine how you can correctly differentiate adrenal cortical adenoma from carcinoma. So these are rare tumors, comprises of 0.05% to 0.2% of all malignancies. It has a bimodal age distribution with a small peak in the first two decades and a larger peak in the fifth decade. These are more common in female than male patients. Keep in mind that a small proportion of adrenocortical carcinomas can be familial. So there is always a syndromic setting that you have to keep in mind, particularly when they present with unusual bilateral familial type of situations. And we will talk more about these, particularly for pheochromocytoma, where the familial part is very, very important. 80% of these tumors are functional. They are typically large tumors greater than 5 centimeters, often bulky, measuring more than 100 grams. And this size and weight can be particularly very important for pediatric tumors, which we will talk again later on when we talk about some of the criteria for malignancies. And these tumors typically have a variegated cut surfaces with frequent necrosis. And the criteria for malignancy can be difficult to determine, but it differs based on the age, whether you are dealing with a pediatric or adult patient, and the type of tumor, whether you are dealing with a conventional or oncocytic tumor. And I will talk separately about oncocytic tumors, which in my opinion are very difficult tumors sometimes to categorize. So this is the latest WHO classification of adrenocortical carcinoma, which divides these tumors into three types. Conventional, which comprises more than 90% of adrenocortical carcinoma. Small proportion of them are pediatric age group. And then you have a variant morphology, which is typically three types: oncocytic, myxoid, which is abundant extracellular connective tissue mucin, and then sarcomatoid. And this is the latest WHO classification for adrenocortical carcinoma. And we will talk about some of these things more in detail. So keep in mind that the determination of malignant potential within an adrenocortical tumor is not that easy. It depends on a multifactorial evaluation of various histological as well as clinical and gross specimen characteristics. The most widely utilized system for the conventional adrenocortical tumors is the WISE criteria, which utilizes 9 criteria, which are listed here for you. And if you have more than 3 out of 9 criteria, then patient have a higher likelihood of having a malignant potential or malignant means adrenal cortical carcinoma. But some of these criteria have been shown to be not reproducible, particularly nuclear grade, diffuse architecture, greater than 30%, and sinusoidal invasion. So then some investigators have proposed a modified WISE criteria, which is composed of these 5 criteria: mitotic rate greater than 5 per 50 high power field, which has a weightage of 2 points. Clear cells comprising less than equal to 25% has again weightage of 2 points. Atypical mitosis, necrosis, and capsular invasion has a 1 point. So if you have again 3 or more criteria out of 7, then patient has a higher likelihood of malignant potential. And now modified WISE criteria, in my opinion, are most widely utilized for determination of malignant potential within these adrenocortical tumors. But keep in mind that these are guidelines. You really need to systematically look at the tumor to determine the malignant potential of these tumors. For patients presenting in pediatric age group, there are Wienke criteria, which has 8 features: tumor weight greater than 400 gram, tumor size greater than 10.5 centimeter, and then you have all these other histological parameters, and if you have score greater than 3, it is associated with malignant behavior. For oncocytic tumors, you have again your own criteria, which are proposed by Lean, Weiss, Bisclia criteria. And if you have any of these vascular invasion, mitotic activity, atypical mitosis, then it is considered major criteria, and any major criteria would be associated with malignant behavior. And if you have any of this one, tumor greater than 10 centimeter or greater than 200 gram, presence of necrosis, capsular invasion, sinusoidal invasion, and any of these features without any major criteria would be labeled of uncertain malignant potential. There is also criteria proposed, which is known as reticulin algorithm, which focuses on the overall architecture of the tumors. If you have an altered reticulin framework with any of these parameters, venous invasion, mitotic activity greater than 5 per 50 high power field, or necrosis, it is associated with malignant behavior. And then finally, you have Helsinki scoring system, which is again has a different weightage. For necrosis, you have 5 points. For mitotic activity greater than 5 per 50 high power field, you have 3 points. And then you have a numerical value of Ki-67, which also has a 3 points. So if you have a score greater than 8.5, it is associated with malignant potential. So keep this type of criteria handy for your practice, and try to evaluate systematically to see what type of criteria you have within this type of specimens. So let me show you some examples, which in my opinion are abnormal features when you see these adrenal cortical tumors. Now, at low power here in this particular tumor, first thing you notice is that pretty much 100% of the cellular composition is made up of eosinophilic. So that is clearly an abnormal finding, and these are not oncocytic cells. We will talk more about that, but these are eosinophilic cells. So you have a criteria of greater than 25% of the cells composed of eosinophilic cells. So that is clearly an abnormal finding. Other thing you can note here is that the tumor has a solid or almost diffuse sheet-like architecture. So if you do reticulin stain, you will see that the reticulin framework is abnormal. Here you have much larger nests, which are separated by vasculature, compared to very delicate small alveoli or small nest of tumor cells, which should be separated by reticulin framework. And I will show you an example of that. Other thing you notice here that these tumor cells are very monotonous compared to this random type of cytological ATPia, which is more characteristic of benign neuroendocrine type of tumors. So here is at high power, you can see more diffuse type of true cytological ATPia. Cells are monotonous, but their nuclei are clearly abnormal, characterized by coarse chromatin, prominent nucleoli, frequent abnormal mitotic activity, also frequently identifiable mitotic activity, and note this dense sheet of eosinophilic cells. So these are clearly abnormal features. And then here in this example, you have this geographic areas of tumor necrosis. So when you see these type of features in combination, that is clearly a sign of an adrenocortical carcinoma. Ki-67 is also considered a very important parameter for evaluation. When you have more than 5% tumor cells positive for proliferation markers within 100 cells, it's typically associated with malignancy. And here is an example of this disrupted reticulin network. Here is the normal reticulin network, while here you can see that this reticulin has much broader sheet-like architecture with loss of that delicate organized vasculature type of pattern that is characteristic of a benign adenomas. So the prognosis of adrenal carcinoma depends on stage. It also can depend on Helsinki score. Score greater than 8.5 is associated with metastatic potential. Overall prognosis is poor for these patients. 5-year survival after surgery range from 40% to 70%. And pediatric and oncocytic tumors tend to have a better survival than conventional one, while myxoid and sarcomatoid types have poor survival than the conventional type. Recently, Sean Gupta have shown that 70% of TERT altered tumors is associated with metastasis. So there is a more and more these genomic studies are also coming out. And I think it is an exciting area right now for investigational point of view. So let me share with you that I think this is a kind of, again, a summary of features that if they are present within your case, that should be a big no-no to diagnose that particular tumor as a benign adenoma. So if you see diffuse sheet-like or solid growth pattern, if you see mucinous differentiation, if you see disrupted reticulin pattern, if you see any tumor necrosis, if you see frequent or atypical mitosis, if you see true cytological atypia, I'm not talking about random neurotype, neuroendocrine type degenerative atypia, and I will show you an example of that. And then when you have vascular or capsular invasion. So in this type of situation, even though you may not have all the criteria to make a definitive diagnosis of adrenocortical carcinoma, any of these features when present, in my opinion, is a big no-no for adrenocortical adenoma diagnosis. And in that type of setting, you want to diagnose those tumors as a tumors of uncertain malignant potential. So here is an example of, again, solid or sheet-like architecture. This is big no-no for adenoma. You should also do reticulin when you face in this type of situation. But most of the time you will notice disrupted reticulin network, which is nicely shown here. So this is what a normal reticulin pattern would look like, rich, organized, delicate, surrounding few clusters of cells, compared to here an example of an adrenocortical carcinoma where you see total loss of this reticulin framework. So that can be a very, very helpful assessment as well. We talked about true cytological atypia, and here is an example of random degenerative atypia, which is characteristically also referred to as a neuroendocrine type of atypia. And this type of atypia is not indicative of malignancy. They can be associated with benign adrenocortical adenoma as well as pheochromocytoma. So that should not be overinterpreted as an evidence of abnormal feature. So again, any of these features, you want to diagnose adrenocortical tumor of uncertain malignant potential. And I think you should have a somewhat lower threshold when any of these tumor, any of these morphological features are present, because you don't want to end up in a situation that you call something adenoma and patient recur or metastasize within a couple of years. I think that can be a difficult situation. So let's talk about these oncocytic tumors. These are very rare tumors, but clearly oddballs, which can be very difficult to categorize and differentiate from abnormal features. So as seen here in this example, these tumors are rich in mitochondria, which gives it an abundant granular eosinophilic cytoplasm. So very similar to oncocytoma of kidney. And that's why on gross appearance, they also look like dark brown, mahogany brown type of tumors. You may also encounter smaller eosinophilic cells within these tumors. And a very important thing to remember that if you are dealing with an oncocytic tumor, in that situation, it has been shown that the diffuse growth is acceptable even for a tumor to be considered benign if there are no other abnormal features. So that is a something unusual. So it is when you deal with a very eosinophilic tumor, try to differentiate whether you are dealing with a true abnormal population of eosinophilic cells or are you dealing with this oncocytic category of tumors. But these tumors can be benign, can be borderline or malignant. And as you can see here that many of these tumors are put in borderline categories because they are really difficult to fully differentiate from these other eosinophilic cells of categories of tumors, which are usually associated with malignant behavior. So diagnosis in this category is based on Lean-Weiss dysclalia criteria, which I showed you earlier. And it is more likely malignant in male patients. So that's another important point to keep in mind. And usually prognosis is better than the conventional type. So now we talked about adrenal cortical tumor. Next spectrum is the adrenal medullary tumors. So again, let's try to understand the normal histology of adrenal medullary cells. And here is a side-by-side comparison of adrenocortical and medullary cells. Notice here the cytoplasm is very different for adrenal medullary cells. They are made up of chromaffin cells, so that gives them a distinct basophilic character to them. These are the cells which produce catecholamines, means epinephrine and norepinephrine, and they are very richly vascular neuroendocrine cells. So typically they are very vascular with a delicate intricate branching vasculature. And some of these cells may show also PAS positive hyaline globules. So if you pay attention to this adrenal medullary histology, then you will often be able to pick up pheochromocytomas and medullary based pathology more easily. So keep this particular histology in mind. So pheochromocytoma is, of course, the most important tumor within the category of adrenal medullary pathology. When they are only involving the adrenal gland, they are also known as intraadrenal paraganglioma, while the word paraganglioma is typically referred to extra-adrenal setting. So when you see that within only adrenal gland, refer to that as a pheochromocytoma. And that distinction is again important for some of the association with familial syndromes. Majority of these tumors are sporadic, but over 10% of these tumors can be familial. And familial tumors are typically associated with bilaterality, multicentricity, as well as extra-adrenal paraganglioma. So when you have any of these features, think about various syndromes that can be associated with pheochromocytoma, particularly when you see an pheochromocytoma in top of extra-adrenal paraganglioma, that is a big flag to suggest that you might be dealing with a familial syndromes. And it is very important to have a genetic counseling of these patients, particularly with now new understanding regarding succinate dehydrogenase deficient syndrome or familial paraganglioma syndromes. And I will talk about that as well. These tumors present with clinical features of catecholamines hypersecretion. So typically there is a sympathetic dominance characterized by headache, palpitations, hypertension, anxiety, and diaphoresis. And vast majority of these tumors are functioning. Only small proportion of these tumors can be non-functioning. They are typically never biopsied because a biopsy can induce a more catastrophic reaction, which could be fatal in this type of settings. Adrenal pheochromocytomas are typically known as 10% tumors, so 10% can be associated with familial, 10% of them can be bilateral, 10% of those tumors are potentially malignant. So classically, it has been linked as a 10% tumor. So let's review the morphology, which can be again quite varied, but this is the classic pheochromocytoma presentation characterized by lobular arrangement of cells in a zalbolon type of pattern, which is characterized by very rich, intricately branching delicate vasculature, which also can mimic with renal cell carcinoma, as well as potentially with adrenal cortical carcinoma. But again, this is paying attention to this delicate cell volume type of network. And again, also note that the cells have a more basophilic or amphophilic look compared to that eosinophilic look, which is more typical of adrenocortical based tumors. Here is another example showing nice small cell volume type of nest. And here we see this some random degenerative type of neuroendocrine atypia, which is not a sign of malignancy for adrenal tumors. In this particular example, you see solid pattern with somewhat clear cytoplasm. So again, when patient present with this type of morphology, it may be confused with metastatic clear cell, renal cell carcinoma, adrenocortical carcinoma. So very important to thoroughly work up these type of settings. These tumors can be also richly vascular and can be mimicker of renal cell carcinoma, which are also typically very vascular tumors, particularly clear cell renal cell carcinoma. In a small proportion of patients, pheochromocytoma can be associated with foci of neuroblastoma, ganglioneuroblastoma, ganglioneuroma, or a malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumor. But keep in mind that predominant component should be pheochromocytoma, and most of the composite pheochromocytoma are still associated with benign behavior. Unless you have some malignant component, then that can potentially determine the biologic outcome for those tumors. If you do S100 staining, you will often find this very delicate network of pigmented, immunoreactive cells, which is the sustentacular cells, which typically pick up this S100 immunoreactivity. And that can be, again, quite helpful to distinguish in some difficult tumors. So like adrenocortical tumors, the determination of the malignant potential for pheochromocytoma can also be quite challenging. Keep in mind that there are no absolute criteria for malignancy. Presence of lymph node or distant metastasis is the only reliable criteria to determine malignancy. But then there are over 12 criteria which has been proposed, which are also known as a pheochromocytomas of the adrenal gland scale score, or commonly referred to as a PAS score. And PAS score greater than 4 has a higher risk of malignant potential. But I do find this particular system very non-reproducible, particularly if features like nuclear hyperchromasia, profound nuclear pleomorphism, tumor cell spindling, cellular monotony, large nest or diffuse growth, high cellularity. Some of these criteria appears quite subjective. So I think keep in mind that I think this is not a very reproducible system, but surgeon may request you to determine the PAS score. And I think if you are dealing with a borderline type of situation, I would also suggest doing a proliferation marker for these tumors. So let us talk about the syndromes. Very, very important, as we talked about 10% of pheochromocytomas and as many as 30% to 40% of paragangliomas, which are the extra adrenal tumors, can be associated with syndromes. Typically in that setting, tumors are going to be bilateral, multiple, often present in young age, associated with other clinical phenotype or familial history. So when you deal with any of these type of potential situations, particularly when you deal with pheochromocytoma, and on top of that, you have an extra adrenal paraganglioma, you must think about genomic potential syndromes. Pheochromocytomas are strongly associated with MEN syndrome 2A and 2B. Lifetime pheochromocytoma risk is almost 50% for these patients. And these patients can have medullary thyroid cancer, primary hyperparathyroidism, as well as mucosal neuromas. small proportion of them can be associated with VHL syndrome. But then there is this new understanding of this familial paraganglioma syndrome, in which you have gene mutations involving the mitochondrial enzymes involved in the oxidative phosphorylation. And there are four genes, STHA, STHB, STHC, and STHD. Particularly, STHB is associated with a more malignant malignant nature, and you can see that they are typically more extra adrenal with a 20 to 30% of risk of having also a pheochromocytoma. So whenever I deal with extra adrenal paraganglioma, or when I deal with pheochromocytoma, in top of that I have any paraganglioma, I always do SDHB stain, and you may get loss of staining, which could be strongly associated with this potential syndrome. These patients also have a risk of developing GIST, and STHB deficient tumors may be associated with renal cell cancers. So think about some of these syndromes, and you don't want to miss the opportunity to diagnose some of these particular familial syndromes. Few words about secondary tumors. As we talked about, adrenal gland is highly vascular tumor, so they are frequently could be site of metastasis. It is involved in 30% of patients with metastatic tumors of diverse site origin, and frequently they can be bilateral. Lung and breast account for 60% of metastasis, followed by kidney, GI tract, melanoma, thyroid gland, liver, and lymphoma. And they can be multiple or solitary. So I think particularly when you are dealing with unusual tumor, always keep metastasis in your differential diagnosis, and you must work up thoroughly these tumors to correctly diagnose them. So here is the immunohistochemical workup that you may find it very helpful. Depending on the algorithm that we work, if you are dealing with a somewhat uncertain type of tumor, first, very important thing to determine is whether you are dealing with a cytokeratin positive or cytokeratin negative tumor. Primary adrenal-based tumors are typically cytokeratin negative. That is especially true for pheochromocytoma. They are always cytokeratin negative. Adrenocortical tumors can be rarely cytokeratin positive. But this is your early screening approach. If they are cytokeratin positive, you have to keep metastatic carcinoma in your differential diagnosis. So then next step is if you are dealing with a cytokeratin negative or weakly positive tumor, then you have to keep in mind that you have to have a differentiation panel for adrenocortical to from pheochromocytoma. So typically calretinin, MELAN-A, SF1, inhibin, and chromogranin can be useful markers in your panel. Adrenocortical-based tumors are typically calretinin, MELAN-A, SF1, inhibin positive. Chromogranin is importantly negative for adrenocortical tumor, but positive for pheochromocytoma. Synaptophysin can be positive in both tumors. For pheochromocytoma, other marker that has been suggested to be useful is also OCT4. We talked about S100 positive sustentacular tumor cells. And then you have, if you are dealing with a neuronal tumors, then you are potentially, you may have to include a panel of these neuronal markers. And these are, again, this spectrum can be cytokeratin negative. So if you don't have these markers positivity, you have to think about some of these unusual tumors as well. And then in metastatic and this type of setting, you need to have another broader panel depending on the type of situation. So use these markers kind of generously. I think in adrenal tumors evaluation, immunohistochemistry, in my opinion, is an integral part of evaluation, unless you are dealing with a pure adrenal, more straightforward adrenocortical adenoma or myelolipoma or cyst type of situations. But other than that, I think you may want to keep immunohistochemical panels in your differential for differential diagnosis. Here is the same markers which I talked about it in a table form, which you can utilize to determine the utility of these markers. And final few words about myelolipoma. It is uncommon benign tumor-like lesion composed of mature adipose tissues, which is admixed with hematopoietic cells. So look for this kind of multilobated megakaryocytic cells that can provide you a useful clue. You may also find some erythroblast and myeloblast and megagranular cells. And it can be also associated with adenoma. Most are unilateral in presentation. So I hope this was a very helpful, simplified approach towards the evaluation. When you next time encounter this specimen, please leave a comment to tell me that how did you find this approach or this presentation to help in your diagnosis. And again, don't forget to like the video, share with your colleagues and friends, and subscribe to this channel. Thank you very much for your attention.